The big ship sailed through the alley, alley, oh. The alley, alley, oh. The alley, alley, oh. The big ship sailed through the alley, alley, oh. On the last day of September. The big ship sailed through the alley, alley, oh.
One of the philosophies I think about painting and living as I live as an artist, is that I live as a topographical artist, recording things, and I don't really have the idea that I'm any more than that. I'm merely a device to record and find things in the place that I feel are worth keeping them as a record, that is. And I don't think really that there's any more to it than that. It's not a job that's got an inspiration or a blinding flash of great romance and moments of static beauty. It's something that's just a search for something. And I find the things that have impressed me more than anything else are usually those that come at the end of a very long day when I'm rather tired. And suddenly, at that moment, it seems as if you see something very clearly. In a town like Salford, you either lived in what was relatively a poorer district, or you lived in a more affluent area. And we always lived, and I grew up in a poorer district. And I think that marked me. I mean, as Wordsworth said, the child being the father of the man, I think what happened was that I found it very difficult to never to be able to disassociate the impressions from those years from my mind. And as I'm a romantic, basically, it's always had a very great influence. It's made a love for the scene, and it's a love-hate relationship, because I realise it's very ugly, on the one hand, but I can never get away from the excitement of it. The most encouraging step in my career was having an exhibition at the City Art Gallery in Salford, which I had when I was 13. That was probably the most encouraging thing, because it was at that particular time that I met Mr. Lowry. Lowry, in fact, took a great interest in what I did from that time, as the City Art Gallery did. And from that point on, it was clear that I wanted to go to art school. I applied to go to the Slade when I was 17, and that's really quite young to apply to go there, because it's largely a postgraduate college. But I was quite lucky. The professor at that time, Coldstream, quite liked my drawings. I hadn't got really any paintings to show, because we didn't do very much painting, and the ones I did were really rather schoolboyish and not very good. But I think they may have seen something in my drawings. Anyway, they accepted me. Thank you. recording the city as part of the project, Mr. Frape, who was the curator of the City Art Gallery, he had a dream that the city would be recorded during 100 years. And he had this dream because of an instinct that at the beginning of the century, you were still in the middle, embedded in the nature of an industrial town, a town which went back to the beginning of the Industrial Revolution and had become a potpourri for all elements of it in Lancashire: the cotton industry, heavy engineering, coal mining, spinning and weaving of every variety, really. High technological development within the electrical and chemical industries. And it was also a port, because large ocean-going ships could come up from the sea to it. So it was a special sort of town, but at the beginning of the century, when Lowry started to paint it, before the First World War and after, between the two wars, there was a certain stability in the nature of the industrial things you could see, the industrial nature of the town. But he also realized it was going to change, which was very brilliant of him in a way. And what he didn't count on was Lowry recording it for 50 years. And I came in 30-odd years ago, really, to start as a young boy with this involvement. Now, if it goes on to the end of the century, well, you will have had 100 years of specifically, topographically relating artists, individuals, to the project of recording a life cycle in a place, how they saw it, and how the change occurred from one era, which had gone on for some centuries, into a new time. And if that happens, if one manages to do it for 100 years, well, what you would have is something which I think is probably quite unique. Nobody ever did it, certainly as a sustained project for that amount of time. And the idea of doing it with an industrial town rather than a glamorous town, if you like, seems very interesting. The difference between Lowry and I, in our attitudes to the environment, is, I think, rather an interesting question, because Lowry interested me clearly in the ability to paint the environment, to paint the scene. But his attitude to it was always one of an observer from a distance. He was separated from the locality, and when he painted the people, he painted a crowd always. He was never involved in singular aspects of a crowd. I was really always, in a sense, feeling that I was amongst the crowd. So my relationship to the landscape was one of somebody being in the crowd, in the place, as opposed to somebody looking at it from a distance. So the environment, the environmental effect in Lowry's painting is one of a rather cold, objective, unemotional observer. The landscape he painted, I reacted against, but at the same time, although I reacted against it because I felt I was amongst it, the influence of being able to paint it and finding it an exciting subject was a very paramount influence. Photography interests me, and has always interested me since I had a box camera during the war my father gave me, and I took the first pictures with that. And the things I took initially were photographs of the family, and then I was bored with that. My father showed me how to process the film at that time, and we bought a fairground camera, which is called a wet camera, in the sense that on fairgrounds you would take someone's photograph and then you would dip the actual paper into a chemical, and lo and behold, up would come a picture. And between that and the box camera, I had to find other subjects because soon I ran out of snapping the family and friends, and I didn't want to wait for events going on holidays and what have you. So I started to make pictures of the streets and the people that lived in the streets around where we lived. And that time I was really around about the age of my daughter Kate. I was 8 or 9. And I've really been interested and involved in the camera since that time. Although when I was at the Slade, it's interesting, I never used it at all. I never photographed anything in London. And I never used the camera at that time. It was totally sort of painting and drawing. I think the camera has the ability to bring to you things from your instincts that the human nervous system can find, but in the normal course of events, because of painting and drawing being a slow relative process, could never reveal. Painting and drawing couldn't reveal it. But the camera as a mechanism allows the arresting of nervous reactions to things which are subliminal and you don't know quite how they happen or why they come. And I find that very, very fascinating. People in the place I paint is really something to do with the mark society has had upon people living in that circumstance. That's to say, they live in a very poor way. Now, in living in a poor way, the thing I want to paint isn't their poverty. It's not the miscellaneous rubbish that they live amongst. The thing that I want to paint or try to find is the human mark of the human spirit in that situation. It isn't a political statement to say that they are wrongfully treated being like that, and it isn't meant to be a social comment to say let's get them out of that situation. It's merely, in a sense, an observation to say this is what the human being in such a situation can do and can reveal the more beautiful elements of humanity in such a state. Thank you.
You know the suitcase?
Yes.
What is it?
The knocker-up, isn't it?
Why do you think he's called the knocker-up?
Because he goes around and knocks at people's windows and wakes them up.
Yep, he does. What do you think he says when he gets to the window? Matter of fact, I'll tell you, why do you... Do you know why he's better than, an alarm clock?
No.
But when he gets to the windows, he keeps on knocking. And he knocks and he knocks. I mean, if he knocks at this window, he'll sort of say, "Come on, Ada, get up." And he'll keep on knocking until she comes to the window. So consequently, of course, when she comes to the window, he knows she's up. I suppose with an alarm clock, she could just go back to sleep again. You ever seen one?
No.
This one was called Mr. Wilmslow. Never been to Wilmslow, he said. He had a dog. What do you think his dog was called?
Winnie.
Oh, pardon?
Winnie.
Winnie?
Yeah.
No, I'm sure it was called Winnie. Called Fred.
I had the idea at one time, because of nostalgia, because of sentiment for the old part of Salford, that I probably would never be involved in the new kind of things which are being built, the new blocks of flats and new estates, and therefore I would probably go away, maybe. But I was quite wrong about that, because I've discovered that the change has brought a new type of living and environment to the town. And the advent of the breakup of society as one knew it before fascinates me. Vandalism fascinates me. Graffiti fascinates me. The violence which is just below the surface in the community fascinates me. The very difficult economic situation that people have suffered recently and the way they've reacted to it fascinates me. A bingo hall fascinates me. I think, like Shaddai in the kitchen, I have no legitimate excuse to ever move away.